Okay, this is Math 30S Pre-Calculus Grade 11. Use this video in conjunction with your notes and assignments, of course. A little bit discombobulated here for the first week, but we'll get her all together there shortly. Alright, so week 1, day 1. Next slide. Alright, so I'm going to do an overview of the type of stuff we're going to learn on the course. Here you go. Here's the type of stuff you're going to learn. Well, of course, back in grade 10, you studied, our first unit is Unit A, Quadratic Equations, or Quadratic Functions. So back in grade 10, you had studied things that were lines, or linear equations, and we called them linear equations because the graph looked like a line. So take Alexis, for example. She's got a sister named Kayla. Kayla's 3 years younger, so you can make a fancy formula that says Alexis is K minus 3, if we're talking about ages here. Or you could do a fancy table, or you could do a pretty picture. You could do a graph. But notice that when you plot all those dots for their different ages, that Kayla and Alexis, their ages are a linear relationship. Every time Kayla gets 1 year older, Alexis gets 1 year older. Now, up at the left there, we're going to start studying things that have a square in them. And look what happens when you get those. All right, you end up with, whoops, I hit the wrong button there. You end up with things that look like this. You ready? Wow. So you get things with humps in them. They're called parabolas, by the way. So that's what Unit A is all about. Right, trigonometry. We're going to learn about trigonometry. Now, the trigonometry we've studied so far in grades, 9, 10, always involved right-angle triangles. It turns out that the best way to look at triangles is actually by looking at circles, all right? So we've studied 90-degree triangles, but the best way to look at triangles is really, and trigonometry, is to look at circles, all right? So there's what, oh, what did I do there? All right, let's do this. Here we go. Is to look at circles. Don't worry, I'll get used to this new software. So it turns out when you graph going around the circle, it looks like that wave down there at the bottom. All right, so we'll be doing lots of that. And back to the triangles here again. So when we studied triangles, it was only right angle triangles. So you only did right angle triangles, RA triangles. Now, how do you solve a triangle that doesn't have right angles in it? How about if you got something that's 40 in each corner and 100 degrees there? And of course, that's an isosceles triangle. And of course, since the two angles are congruent, the opposite sides have to be the same length. Well, you only studied triangles like on the right with a square corner in them. And you studied that the long side squared equals the sum of the squares of the other two sides. But we only knew how to do right angle triangles. Well, guess what? See that triangle in the center there? You can turn it into two right angle triangles. Well, if you can do a right angle triangle, then you can do two of them. So it turns out there's a formula to calculate this. You just say x squared equals 7 squared plus 7 squared, and you go, woohoo, that looks like Pythagoras. Well, except it's not, because Pythagoras only worked for the right angle triangle, so you got to keep going. You end up doing this sort of crap, and next thing you know, you got a formula. All right, there you go. There's how you do trigonometry when you don't have 90 degree corners. Next slide. Then we're going to do some algebra. All right, let's do the algebra. Engage. So you know how to do simple linear algebra. You know, things with just an x in it, like 2x plus 1 equals 7. And then you did all that fancy math and said x equals 3. Or you could say two buckets of x plus 4 equals 3 x's. And then you had to get the x's all onto the one side and match up like terms and calculate it and all that. We're not going to do it because you know how to do that. And we could even get crazy and use fractions. And you know what? It's the exact same steps. Not a problem. You guys are pretty good at that stuff. If you're not, see me, because you should know how to do this. All right. Even if you're not really going to use it anymore and apply it. Oh, this is pre-cal. Oh, yeah. You'll be using this in pre-cal. All right. So anyway, you're going to be learning some algebra, but now you're going to have x squareds, all right? So if I said something squared minus 9 equals 0, well, most of you agreed that 3 squared minus 9 would equal 0. And I went, woohoo, you're right. But you know what? Minus 3 works as well. Ooh, there's two answers to this. Guess what? When you got an equation with a square in it, there's actually two answers. Kind of crazy, eh? If it's got a cube in it, there's three answers. All right. So notice that, there was two answers there. X equals positive 3 and x equals negative 3. All right, because there's two answers for that unknown. Next slide. All right, and then you get to graph it and all that, because you can solve almost any problem in the world by drawing a picture of it. It may not be exact, but hey, you'll get a pretty rough idea what the answer is. So you'll be doing this sort of stuff. And this is all called algebra. When you solve and figure out what an unknown thing is, it's called algebra. All right, so there's a picture of that last problem. Notice that the possible answers are there. And there. All right, so those are your possible answers at negative 3 and positive 3. 3 and negative 3. That's where it crosses the x-axis. All right, so anyway, we'll be doing tons of that. Okay, lots more to go. Algebra, yeah. Guess what? You use algebra all the time when you throw something through the air. There's the actual equation for something flying through the air. Your height is a function of your time. And there's the actual equation for me throwing a baseball. And I know that negative 5 means I'm on Earth, by the way. Anyway, you could actually just graph a pretty little graph here and plot the dots, and you'll end up with that shape, funny enough. And that looks like how a baseball goes flying through the air. And then you can calculate that it's going to hit the ground after 4 seconds using a bit of algebra. But we'll save that for then. Analytic geometry. All right, unit D. We're going to look at slopes of lines and parallel lines and perpendicular lines. But more importantly, we're going to look at things with squares in them. All right, and more importantly than that, we're going to look at things where the y is squared as well. So, you know when you got just the y and just an x in an equation that you get a line. And you know that when you got just a y and you got x squared somewhere in an equation, you got a parabola. What happens when you square the y too? Look what you get. Woohoo! A circle. All right, and we discuss the crap out of that. Here you go. Then we're going to do geometry. All right, so geometry, we're going to look at the shapes inside of a circle. We're going to start drawing shapes inside of a circle. All right, now it's just like a pizza. If you decided to cut out a slice of pizza, you could cut out a 50-degree slice of pizza. Now, you could cut out a slice but go to the edge instead of to the center. Well, it turns out the piece that goes to the edge is exactly half the angle of the piece that goes to the center. Right? Try it the next time you have pizza. Of course, your buddies will beat you for cutting your slice that way, but it works. No matter where you cut that slice to the circumference, it works. And by that same logic and whatever, every goalie in the universe knows this, that if you stand on the crease of a lacrosse pitch goal, that is a perfect 90-degree corner. All right. So if you ever want to make a perfect 90-degree corner, inscribe a triangle inside of a circle. How about consumer math? We do a unit on consumer. We're going to learn how income works and deductions off your income, which means taxes, and EI and CPP, and how to exchange money, and what's the best buy when you're shopping. Do you buy the 2-liter Coke or the 2 6-packs? Or just the other day, I was looking at Coke, milk. Look at that. A 2-liter was on sale for $2.65. It still is. I was there this morning. This has been on for 2 weeks now. On sale for $2.65, 2 liters. The exact same milk, the same brand, the same company. 2 1-liters is $1.25. That doesn't make sense. Why would you buy the 2-liter when the 2 1-liters would be cheaper? Anyway, you're going to learn about property tax and loans and savings and payday loans and credit cards and all that scary stuff. So anyway, let's start our first unit. Let's start quadratic equations, quadratic functions, rather. So read and do pages 1 to 3 in your notes. Everybody has the notes. They're online with my website. And I asked you to graph something. All right, so here's an equation. Y equals x squared minus 6x plus 5. All right. And just like with lines, if you want to graph something, look for a pattern, you want to find a bunch of points on a grid. And you pick a couple x's, use that recipe there, that equation to calculate what the y is. Notice you're only going to get one y. You plug in an x, square it, take away 6 of the x, add 5, and you'll get one y is the answer. It's called a function when you get one y. And watch this, let's do it. So I'll conveniently pick nice, comfortable, convenient x's for you, but if you don't start with 0, you're crazy. You should always figure out what happens when you plug 0 into a machine. It's just a smart thing to do. All right, what happens when this machine is turned off? It's kind of important. All right, so you graph all those, correction, you evaluate that function for a whole bunch of x's, and then you plot the points, and you know how to do that. It's exactly the same as doing a line, except you're going to do it with something that has squares in it now. Ooh, so you got to know a little bit about exponents and how to square something, multiply it by itself. Next slide. And where do you see parabolas? You see them in bridges and satellite dishes, and every time something flies through the air, you see parabolas, all right? And you see them also when you maximize profit, all right? So if you're gonna figure out what price to charge for your hot dogs, you know, price of your hot dog versus how much profit you make, you know, you're out to make profit, right? So do you charge $0 for your hot dog, or do you charge $10 for your hot dog? Well, at $0, you can charge $0 and get 1,000 customers and you make zero money. Or you could charge $10 and, of course, nobody's going to buy it. So $10 times zero customers is still zero money. So somewhere in between is going to be the perfect amount to charge for your hot dogs, you know, where you don't turn off customers or undersell yourself. All right, so if you don't think that you use this in business, you're crazy. All right, let's try this. Some other convenient features or features of a parabola. They have a vertex where they reverse and change direction. All right, so there you go. They also have an intercept. Well, every function that we look at, every polynomial expression has an intercept. It will cross the y. You can always plug in an x and calculate an x of 0. You can always plug in an x of 0 and find the y, all right, for every function we're going to study. Anyway, notice that there's a line of symmetry. All right, we're going to do the entire unit. This is, we got about a week to do this. Notice the thing opens down. Sometimes it'll open up. Notice that everything to the right of the line of symmetry looks like everything to the left of the line of symmetry, especially if I was doing it nice and neatly. All right, so there you go. Notice it's got x-intercepts. It crosses the x-axis at, in this case, two places. Sometimes it doesn't cross at all. Sometimes it just kisses at one spot. All right, so there are some of the key characteristics or features of a parabola. It has a vertex where it changes direction. It has y-intercept. It has x-intercepts. It has a symmetry. It opens up or down. All right, next slide. Okay, so let's do another one. This is in the notes. Negative x squared plus 6x minus 2. So there is the secret recipe for this polynomial. All right, it's a polynomial expression on the right there. And that is the value of your y. So it's like grandma's secret recipe for something. She says you take the x, you multiply it by itself, then you make it negative and add it to 6x's and then take away 2. And that tells you how many raisins to put in X muffins, I guess. I don't know, something. It's, this equation must do something. Anyway, there I conveniently pick a few points for you. I conveniently graph them. Bada bing, bada boom. We'll just evaluate. Evaluate means plug in the X's and then do the calculation, figure out the Y. Once you get the Y, you plot the X, comma Y ordered pair on the graph. Bada bing, bada boom. And it'll look something like, where is it here? I think I got one more to go. Bada bing, bada boom, whatever that means. All right, so you're plotting those ordered pairs of numbers, those X's, comma Y's, and it looks like that. Notice this one opened down. Notice it's got a vertex at 3, comma 3. Notice how everything to the right of the line X equals 3 looks like everything to the left of X equals 3. Right, if you go one step to the right of the vertex, the y is 6. If you go one step to the left of the vertex, the y is 6. If you go two steps to the right, the y is 3. If you go two steps to the left, the y is 3. It's got a y-intercept at 0, comma, negative 2, which is a no-brainer. All you got to do is look at the constant at the end of that expression when it's written in that format. Anyway, it opens down. It's got a range, a domain. We've seen all that crap keep going. So here we're doing our warm-up nugget. I like to sometimes hand out little packages that are stuff that we need to review. And technically speaking, you should be familiar with all this stuff because someday your nephew is going to ask you these questions anyways. So make sure you know how to handle integers in pre-calculus. All right. Negative 6 plus a negative 2 is a negative 8. A negative 5 plus a 9 is a 4. If you don't understand how to handle integers, and if you have to cheat and do them on a calculator, you can do that too. But you know what? You should know how to do negative numbers. Negative numbers have been around as long as bankers have. So if you need some help on that, let me know. All right? So you can pause here and make sure you understand it, or come and ask me and we'll sort it out. Next slide. Here's more negative numbers. You should be familiar with how to do this sort of stuff. So I'm just fixing up the second line to make it simpler, and the answer is 7. I like to put a box or a circle around my answer. And those letters are just the answer to the puzzle that we were working on, the answer to the silly riddle. Right? Why did the farmer sleep under the tractor? He wanted to get up oily or something. All right, so here we go. Next slide. Puzzle 13, same sort of crap. If you don't know how to do negatives... Oh, this one's negative negatives. Check that out. Right? I hope you know that taking away a negative... So taking away a negative is the same as adding. All right, if you don't remember that, well, see me. And same thing here. Taking away a negative is the same as adding. So that's really the same as 3 plus 8. So the answer is 11. All right, same thing here. All right, so there you go. Next slide. So I won't animate that. All right, keep going. But the point is here, make sure you know your integers. Okay, absolute value. Absolute value. Now, we only just briefly touched on this back in grade 9 for maybe 20 minutes, if that. But the absolute value is an interesting pair of brackets. It's a function. It's something that you do to a number. And what it does is it strips off the negative. All right? It's called the absolute value. Because sometimes you don't care about whether something's positive or negative. If I said the difference between Arlen's math mark and Sonia's math mark was 8 marks, right? I'm not saying who had more. I'm just saying the difference is 8. Sometimes you only care about how far two numbers are apart, and you don't really care which one is bigger than the other. Okay? So the way you do that, the way you calculate an absolute value, is you put this... There's actually a button on your calculator, does it, by the way, if you know where to find it. But you put this sort of set of pipes around the number, and all it does is strip off the negative. So the absolute value of a negative 1 is 1. So 6 plus the absolute value of 1, correction, absolute value of negative 1 is 6 plus 1 is 7. So those magical absolute value, what I call pipes, just strip off negatives. So see if you can figure this out. If you don't follow that, that's fine. But you will be using absolute value quite a bit, especially in grade 12. Grade 12, you use absolute value quite a bit. It's just a handy little way to calculate the distance between two things, two numbers, without having negative signs. Nobody likes negatives. All right, so make sure you understand that idea. If you don't see me, we can tweak it up. Evaluating. So make sure you know how to evaluate things, especially when you're plugging in negative numbers. A lot of people forget that when you're plugging in negative numbers, evaluate means to plug in a number to give an expression of value. All right, so there's an expression, negative x. Right? It's saying negative whatever the x is. And if somebody says, yeah, but the x is negative 3, well then, that expression becomes a negative negative 3. So always, always plug in brackets. All right, so it's positive 3. Same thing here. Somebody says, yeah, well, you got a negative negative a. And by the way, the a is a negative 20. So really, you got a negative 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 20. So it's, you know, it's sort of like saying to your kid, you can't have no cookies. Well, that's what the first one would be like. I don't know how you'd say the last one. If there's one thing you can't have lots of, it's not no cookies. Something like that. Anyway, it turns out that if you have a negative of a negative, if you got an odd number of negatives, it's going to stay negative. All right. Anyway, give that a shot. Here's some more absolute values just for your entertainment pleasure. All right, there's what they look like. Next slide. When you graph it, we'll do this in grade 12, so, but when you graph an absolute value, it gets kind of kinky, all right? It takes a line and just instantly bends it. So that's not a parabola. Parabolas aren't kinky. They don't have a sharp bend in them. Parabolas are nice, smooth curves. Mother Nature doesn't do kinky bends like that. All right, next slide. So multiplying integers, multiplying negative numbers. All right, so maybe you remember that a negative times a negative is a positive. All right, if you take away a whole bunch of negatives, that's good. If you got a whole bunch of negatives in your life and somebody takes away a whole bunch of negatives, If somebody takes away 8 bunches of 5 negatives, boy, your life just got 40 better, right? You just added 40 to your life. So subtracting a negative is adding. And so subtracting a whole bunch of negatives is even higher adding. So think of it that way. Because multiplying is really just adding. All right, anyway, if you don't understand that sort of thing, let me know. And you should understand why, too. Because when you've got to explain this to your nephew, it's kind of important to know why. All right, let's try this as well. Say you're going to simplify something. You've got 6 X's, and then you got a bouquet with 5 X's in it, less 8 that somebody snuck out. All right, so how many things have you got? Well, you got 6 X's. I like to think of brackets as bouquets, if you're a girl, and buckets if you're a guy. So there you go. There's your buckets and your bouquets. So really, you got 11 X's minus 8. And that's called simplifying. When you simplify something, you just make it simpler. It's a little easier to write 11 X less 8 than it is 6 X's plus a bouquet of 5 X's minus 8. All right, so we're forever simplifying things. It just makes it easier. And then, of course, knowing how to handle monomials and binomials all multiplied together and stuff like that. So if you got 7 bunches of 2x less 4, and then somebody says, oh, well, you got to take away a package that has 10 minus 3x's in it. Look how simple that is. The real answer is you got 17x's minus 38. All right, so if you don't know how to do that sort of stuff, well, see me. Because it's kind of important, especially in pre-cal. This isn't applied math where you can use a little plastic brain to figure these things out. You've actually got to understand some of these ideas. Okay, so here we go. The answer is that, son of a gun. Next slide. Quadratic functions. All right, so we're actually going to do our unit. Look at that. We're starting unit A. We're into our notes. We're not doing review anymore. Here's your first grade 11 lesson. Quadratic functions. So I always hand out note frames. I try to take 90 pages of crap and turn it into 20 for you. So it's always on my website too. So like we did earlier there, when I was doing the overview, you know linear functions. You've done them before. Here's an example of a linear function. You versus your sister, your ages. Right? When you were 0, your sister was 4. When you were 4, your sister was 8. When you were 6, your sister was 10. Guess what? When your sister was 2, you were negative 2. There's a relationship between numbers. And when you graph that pretty picture, I think you'll see that it's a linear relationship. It's a line, because every time you get 1 year older, your sister gets 1 year older. And that's a good clue that all the lines are poking off in the same direction. So we beat the snot out of that in grade 10. Let's check out what you're doing in grade 11. Now in grade 11, your X's and Y's, all right? Grade 11, you're going to have some squares in your formulas. Ooh, and of course, we already saw in the overview, you're going to get these types of curves. So something with a square in it is called a quadratic formula. Quad, believe it or not, in Latin means square, all right? So like a quadrangle. So that'll do that. So you get a parabola, that funny hump shape. And of course, guys see parabolas every morning, don't they, guys? Okay, next slide. So let's take your first parabola and calculate it. So there's your first parabola, negative x squared plus 6x minus 2. This is straight out of the notes, and you're going to... I gave you a few selected numbers to try for x, and then you're just going to plug them into the formula and come up with an answer and plot them and look at that shape. Look at that. Pretty simple, right? Now, of course, it took us a long time to do this. It took us like an hour to calculate those things. In reality, you get computers that do this, but you still have to be able to know how to plug in an X and then calculate the Y that goes with it. All right, so here's a better, here's the actual previous slide. Oh, actually, no, this is the next one, right? That formula was that. Okay, so here's another formula. Now, we'll take our time evaluating this formula for different X's, okay? So we'll take our time evaluating. So we say that the formula, and we call that a function, and we say f brackets x. So that doesn't mean f times x. It means there's a function that does something to an x. So it's not like it's f times x. The way you read that is f of x. The function of x is what? And the function is it takes an x, it squares it, then it triples all that, then it adds 7 x's, and then it takes away 4. Now, normally, to see what the value of a function is, we plot it on the y-axis. So I know this is confusing, but wherever you see an f at x or an f brackets x, just pretend it's a y for now. All right? It just means you're going to take the value of the function and plot it on the y-axis. All right, so we're going to evaluate that for a few points. Here they go. You can pause this anytime you want in YouTube. All right, I'm going to plug in those numbers for you. And make sure when you plug in, you use brackets. Otherwise, when you do the negatives, you're going to be toast. I'm really good at multiplying by zero, by the way. This one's easy, eh? Isn't it minus 4? Goodness, it's just the constant at the end of the expression. Yep, 3 negative 2 squared, that'd be 12 minus 14. 12 minus 14 is negative 2 minus 6. So that should be negative 6 or something, is it? What did I do there? Ooh, I got it. All right, and Sam, you just keep doing this. Now be very careful. Yeah, just wait. We'll let this finish off. 3 negative 4 squared, so that's 48 minus 28. Well, that's not, yeah. 48 minus 28 minus 4. Yep, 16. There you go. Work. That's why we're throwing in the negative numbers inside brackets. Okay? You got to be very careful. Whenever you plug in a number, put it in brackets. And if you're struggling with this, well, you're not the only one. Don't sweat it. You can use a calculator on this if you want, but to tell you the truth, it's not that tough. And chances are you don't know how to use the negative key on your calculator anyways, if you've only got a $2 calculator. If you got a fancy $100 calculator like the ones I use in class, well, yeah, you're laughing. But, all right, so if you got, as long as you spent more than 10 bucks on your calculator, you'd probably be able to do this pretty reliably. In any event, make sure you understand that negative 2 squared is not the same as negative 2 in brackets all squared, all right? That first one, the left one, is you always do the squaring first. So that would be 2 squared, make it negative, it'd be negative 4. This one here would be negative 2 all squared. So negative 2 times negative 2, which would be positive 4. So this would be negative 4, and this would be positive 4. Okay, and they're not the same thing. So again, make sure you're using brackets when you plug in. Otherwise, you'll screw up the negatives. And let's try this one. So we actually did it manually here. We transferred all those points that we calculated to here. I'm sorry. We're doing, which one are we doing here? I'll have to wait. Yeah, okay, so we're doing the first one, the function f of x. And we already calculated those. We're just going to transfer them to here. And when you plot those points, I conveniently picked some points that would stay on the graph. They look like that. Bada bing, bada boom. And I flung in an extra one. Anyway, it looks like all you need is 3, maybe 4 points, 5 ideally, to set you up with a pretty nice looking parabola, right? So how about the g of x? The function g of x. Oops, wrong slide. Next slide, go. So here's g of x. So it's a different machine, a different function, so I give it a different name. So it's a function, it's called the g function. So g does something with an x. That's what that says. G is a function of x. What does it do? It takes 2 times the square of the x, then it takes away 3 of the x's, and it adds 5. Could be grandma's secret recipe for muffins. It could be the distance it takes for your car to stop on a slippery surface. It could be how high a baseball goes. Well, no, because it'd have to be a negative at the front. Anyway. It could be some relationship between different numbers. Let's animate this and go. So we're going to evaluate that expression. Plug into that polynomial expression. All right, I'll just let this go really quick. There's the answers. Yeah, I'm going to do some of them. I'm not doing them all. You did them all on a separate bit of paper. Make sure you get the same answers as I did. Next slide. And when you graph them, son of a gun, look what you get. I didn't graph them all there. I picked select ones that I knew would fit on the graph paper. Notice when we're counting on the graph paper there, we're counting by twos. We're counting up by twos so that bigger numbers will fit on there. I could have picked prettier equations for you, but You can count by twos, can't you? So that you can accommodate a few high values. Okie doke. So there's the basic idea of parabolas. You know that it's something that has a hump in it, and it comes down, and it bottoms out somewhere, or it peaks somewhere, and there you go. So again, you have seen how to graph lines. You know how to do lines right there. If I gave you from grade 10 y equals 3 quarters of an x plus 4, you would plot the y-intercept there at 4, and then you go 4 to the right and up 3. So that's how you would do it, because that number in front of the x tells you something. It tells you the slope of the line, 3 quarters. And you would go 4 to the right, up 3, make a circle, and boom, connect the dots there. You just made a line. Now, pretty soon in pre-cal, you'll be able to see an equation like this and just do the same thing. You'll just go zing, zing on the back of a cigarette pack, and you go, there's what it looks like, and you'll graph it for us, all right? So it's not all that tough. If you knew how to do a line, well then, graph on a parabola is not a heck of a lot more different. So it turns out when you do it that it's going to have a vertex at positive, it's going to have a line of symmetry at positive 2. All right, I'm just showing you that I know how to calculate this. You'll be able to do this too. So I know it's got a line of symmetry at positive 2. So everything to the right of that line looks like everything to the left of the line. The vertical line through x equals 2. And I know that it goes through when the x is 0, the y is negative 10. So obviously it's got a cousin to the right at 4, negative 10. So there's 2 points. I can just go zing, zing. And there's what it looks like. It's not really all that tough. It takes one extra thought cell to think about it. All right. And so there's linear functions. You know how to do those. They're called first degree polynomials because there's a 1 on the there's a 1 as an exponent on x, and of course we are now doing things with a 2, an exponent of 2 on the x. So these are called second degree polynomials, or quadratic expressions, or quadratic equations, if you're going to turn it into an equation. And they're going to give a shape like that. All right, anything with a square in it is going to have that. That sometimes it'll be a 2 in front of the x, sometimes a 4, but it'll be some number times x squared plus some number times x plus some number. All right, we're not just doing simple little lines anymore, right? So we're not doing this stuff anymore. All right, next slide. Let's do another one here, y equals x squared plus 4x minus 8. I think this was an extra one that I gave you in class. This wasn't in the notes. So I give you that. Let's see you graph it. Later on, you'll be able to do these in your head. So a 0 gets you a negative 8. All right? Can you do that in your head? Sure you can. Look, if the x is 0, the first 2 terms disappear, you're left with a negative 8. That's why I like multiplying by 0. How about when the x is 1? Yeah, you got a negative 3. When the x is 2, you got a 4, etc., etc. You don't have to do these in your head, obviously. Chances are a little bit of scrap paper at first. And later on, you'll just find a better way just to draw the curve anyways without doing this. But you'll never be wrong to go and do a table. Tables will always work. And they just take a little extra work. Anyway, plotting all those points, you can readily see that line of symmetry coming down there. And either side of it to the left is exactly the same as to the right. That's why it's called a line of symmetry. All right, pretty soon you'll just be able to skip the table and go straight to the pretty picture. All right, and I showed you how to do it on this graphing calculator. Now, technically speaking, you're not really allowed to use this calculator in pre-cal, because only the applied people go by use a computer to show them things. You guys are supposed to be able to understand in pre-cal all this stuff in your head, all right? But there's the way we do it in applied math, and I'll let you use this graphing calculator just so you can see things a little quicker. I hate spending an hour drawing a simple parabola when this will do it in half of a second. So there's the keystrokes you put in, and you don't use commas, right? I just put the commas there to show you the buttons that you press to separate the keystrokes. So even though there's a comma on this fancy calculator, don't use that. And by the way, somebody in your family's probably got one of these calculators, right? We've been using these for 20 years now. My daughters had these 15 years ago. They've been around for a long time. All right, so somebody in your family's probably got one. If you've never seen one of these before, I would be seriously concerned about the school you went to, that's for sure. Next slide. Now you don't have to use just my fancy calculator. Guess what? I've given you links on my website to a half dozen places where you can type in an equation and it draws it for you there. So this is straight off of a website. Notice how I typed in the equation down there. And it drew the pretty graph right there. So it's not just my fancy $100 calculator that does it. You can do it online, anywhere, and, well, whatever. Okay, here we go. I did this warm-up here, these types of questions. All right, don't want to belabor this. We'll race through this. The point is, if you do not know how to do this type of fraction question, it might be challenging in pre-cal. And second of all, you know, if your nephew finds out you're doing pre-cal in grade 11 and 12, they're going to be asking you lots of math. So it's embarrassing if you don't know how to do this stuff. So, you know, you can't do a brain dump on this stuff, all right? You just got to know this stuff. Next slide. So let's do 1/4 + 3/5. And you know me, I like to do math without numbers. You could do this entire thing just with these chocolate bars. Watch this. There's a quarter of a chocolate bar, and here's 3/5 of a chocolate bar. See the shaded bits? That's the part that still has chocolate. And if I added the quarter to the 3/5, you go, yeah, but quarters and fifths aren't the same size. What are you going to do? So you know what? You chop the top one into 4 slices, and you chop the extra 5 slices that way and 4 slices the next way for the other one. Now everything's in 20s, and you could count up the little chunks of X-lax there or whatever they are, and you got 17/20. There you go. You could actually do fractions, by the way, without numbers. All you got to do is get a chocolate bar or two. Anyway, if you don't quite understand how to do that, see me. Because you're going to be teaching your nephew how to do this crap. And if you just fling numbers in front of them, you're going to turn them off forever. That's why most people are turned off of math. Because it's just a bunch of numbers swimming around on a page. And math never had numbers for the first 10,000 years. It was just pebbles and shapes. You don't need numbers to do math. All right, let's try this thing. What if you got 4 7/8 divided by 1/2? And you might hate this, but get over it. All right, here we go. Well, sometimes you get something complicated like 4 7/8 divided by 1/2. Think of something simpler that you do know how to do. So do you know how to do 12 divided by 3? Sure, your teacher taught you. You put the 3 there like that, and then you put this funny box, and then you put the 12 there, and you're supposed to say 3 goes into 12, whatever the heck that means. Who knows what that means? Or how many 3s can you take out of 12? Or, well, if you could put 3s in, then you can take them out, whatever, right? We don't describe the way we explain dividing in middle school is what turns you off for the rest of your life. The fact remains is, you got 12 things, you want to see how many packages of 3 you can take out of them. So, let's see how many packages of 3 we can take out. There's a 3, leaves us 9, take away another 3, leaves us 6, take away another 3. Hey, we've taken out another package of 3. Look at that, how many times did we take away 3? We took away 3 4 times. There, that's dividing. Believe it or not, dividing is really just subtracting a whole bunch of times. And notice that 3 times 4 is 12. So the opposite of dividing is really multiplying. It's amazing how multiplying, dividing, adding, and subtracting, they're all pretty much the same idea. It just depends on... Okay, anyway, off we go. So here, I like to do the diagram of this on a number line. So there's 4 7/8. See how I chopped up between 4 and 5 into 8 bits, and I took 7 of them. And there's 1/2. See that little purple piece of Kraft dinner? So we're looking at the green spaghetti noodle and the little purple piece of Kraft dinner. So dividing is saying how many of those 1/2 Kraft dinners fit into a 4 7/8 spaghetti noodle. So how many Kraft dinners could you put into or take away from or whatever you want to say? How many of the purple things would go into a green thing? And look. Do you need math for that? Looks like about 1, 2, 3. I'm just eyeballing it. I'm saying it's about 9 and a bit. So I put that little triangle up there. I always like to have a rough idea using my noggin before I start going crazy. So I just say it's 9 and a bit. Right? I like to put a little estimate. Like that's what I put in that diamond at the top. So I'm thinking if I don't get 9 in a bit, then I screwed it up. So anyway, you turn the way you do it with algebra, and math rather, is 4 7/8 is really 39/8. Because 4 whole chocolate bars would be 32/8 plus the 7/8 left over is 39/8 divided by 1/2. And you know how to divide by a fraction. Don't you flip it upside down and multiply? Everybody knows how to multiply straight across the top, straight across the bottom. 78/8, which is really 39/4 when you reduce it. And you know what? Just leave the answer like that. In pre-cal, leave the answer as an improper fraction. I love improper fractions. As soon as you start doing that, oh, now you're going to be a carpenter. Who the heck would combine natural numbers with, who the heck would combine these natural numbers with fractions? Why not just leave it as a nice pure fraction to start with? And don't tell me it's 9.75. I'll just freak out, all right? I don't do decimals in pre-calc, and neither will you. All right, so let's evaluate here. Let's practice evaluating again. Off we go. And make sure you know how to do it on a calculator. That was the purpose of this. I'm trying to show you now how to do it on a calculator to speed things up. But it turns out that most people can't do it on a calculator either. So if you can't do it on paper and you can't do it on a calculator, man, you're pretty much toast. All right. Now, this is why you got to use brackets when you plug in. This is why you got to use brackets when you plug in. All right. Because if you just put down 3 minus 3 squared, well, that would be 3 minus 3 squared instead of what it's supposed to be, 3 times a negative 3 squared. Okay? I'll have to get the phone there in a sec. All right, so you end up doing this math. It turns out when you evaluate this expression, this polynomial expression, this quadratic, when you evaluate this quadratic expression at negative 3, you end up with 44. So make sure you know how to use this plus minus button on your calculator, all right? Because a lot of people don't know how to. Most time, you put the number in first, then you hit that button. But it depends on your calculator. Some $10 calculators are a little more user-friendly, all right? Okay, so here's another thing. If you got 4/5 of a jar of pickles plus 3 pickles that you found under the couch, how many pickles have you got? And somebody says you got 23 pickles. All right, so you got 4/5 of a jar of pickles in the fridge, and then you find 3 more pickles under the couch, and your grandson says, "Hey, Grandpa, we got 23 pickles." So how many pickles must there be in a jar if 4/5 of a jar plus 3 is 23? All right, this is a serious problem. Right, so how many pickles do you have? That's called solving. So solving, find the X, get it by itself, isolate it. So you can actually draw these things. There's a jar of pickles, there's 4/5 of a jar of pickles, plus 3 extra pickles, and I'm drawing 23 pickles on the right there. Because is means equals. I take away the 3 pickles that were under the couch because they're not in the jar. So if you do all this, you can actually show your nephew how to do this. And I could leave off all those numbers and just show pebbles and lines, and you could actually do all algebra with shapes. You don't need any of those numbers in there, by the way. But if you insist on using numbers, here's the way you do it up in the top. 4/5 of an x plus 3 equals 23. You take away 3 off both sides, bada bing, bada boom. Now the x is almost by itself, so to get rid of the 4/5, you multiply by 5/4. As long as you do the same thing to both sides, then you get the rules of algebra down, x is 25. Well, we told you that when we drew the pretty picture, didn't we? The original math did not use numbers. You do not need numbers to do mathematics, folks. They're kind of handy, though. All right, so we're learning about that crap next slide. Okay, let's try this one. Here's another equation that we did, and I was letting you use a graphing calculator to see how this works. Y equals x squared plus 8x plus 6. And I gave you a convenient set of numbers that I know would fit nicely on the graph. So I gave you some convenient x's because I can tell where the vertex is on this. Right? Obviously the vertex is at negative 4. All right, you're going to see it bottom out at negative 4 and then go back up. All right, look at that. Bottoms out at negative 4, negative 10, negative 9 should be next. Negative 6 should be after that because there's symmetry. Bada bing, bada boom. Let's graph the pretty little dots. It's going to be happy face. It looks like that. Whew. And you could put it on the plastic brain. The plastic brain will tell you the same thing, right? Here's the plastic brain telling you the same thing that we just figured out. A little quicker on the plastic brain. Next slide. Let's do another one here. All right. Now, notice I'm doing something different here. This time, instead of having a times x squared plus b times x plus c, this time I don't have an x squared by itself, and I don't have just the x by itself. I've taken the x and I've thrown it in brackets with another number, and then I've squared it. It turns out this is a quadratic. If you remember how to multiply binomials, x minus 5 squared is really x minus 10x plus 25. So it turns out the stuff in the bracket, it turns out this is still a quadratic. All right, it still gives a quadratic relationship. Well, I'll show you here. Here we go. We'll still get a parabola. All right, here's how it evaluates out. You can always hit pause on this if it's going too fast. I'm just trying to keep the time down on these things. It takes me hours to do this crap. All right, you plot the pretty dots and look at her go. Gee, I see some symmetry there. And there on the pretty graph when we did on this plastic brain, notice you got the line of symmetry going up and down at x equals 5. Yep, and notice you got a minimum right there at x equal at correction y equals 2. Yeah, isn't that kind of weird? Yeah, it is kind of weird because look how there's a 5 and there's a 5, and look how there's a 2 and there's a 2 right there. It turns out that vertex, you can tell that vertex just by looking at the formula. That you take the opposite of negative 5 is 5, and you take that and it's 2. And that's what we're going to discover. We'll now spend half hour doing all that crap and discovering, but that's the rule. In any event, let's go back to graphing. Let's not do that. Let's skip that. We did enough of that stuff. Let's do that x minus 5 all squared on the graphing calculator. So make sure you know how to do it. Here's the keystrokes you put in. Right, there's the equation. If you're going to put in the keystrokes, I separate them with commas like that just so you can see what buttons you press. Do not put the commas in the calculator. It'll have a brain fart. Here we go. When you graph those pretty little pictures, it's going to end up looking like that. All right, trust me, it's true. And notice again, we already agreed that you can pretty, well, we'll see how you do that. But it turns out that negative 5, you take the opposite of negative 5, and that's 5. And you just take that number 2 right there, and look at that. It turns out the vertex is at 5, 2. Next slide. Now we'll take a while to discover that. All right, so let's do this. Let's graph the equation y equals 1/2 of an x squared. So the function is 1/2 of an x squared. And we're going to plot the value of the function on the y-axis. All right. So whenever you see that f brackets x, f of x, or f at x, or function of x, it just means the y, pretty much. It means you're plugging a number into some expression, and out comes some number from this function. All right. So when we do that, let's do it on the TI-83. Let's not waste time by doing it in a graph on tables, on paper. So notice that you end up with something like this when you graph it. You end up with a vertex at 0, 0. You end up with a line of symmetry that runs straight down the center line there on your y-axis, right? Like the crosshair on your rifle scope. So that's where x equals 0. So your line of symmetry is where all the x's equal 0. Your domain. Now, domain is all the allowed x's. So we talked about this. We'll talk about it more. But the curve goes forever to the right and forever to the left. At no time does a parabola go straight up, by the way. Right? A parabola does go forever. In fact, every polynomial that we look at, whether it be a square or a cube or a power of 4, they do go forever to the right and they go forever to the left. The range, notice, is it limits your y. Notice that even though the x's can go forever to the left and forever to the right, the y is limited. The y is going to be greater than or equal to 0. And you have y-intercepts where the curve crosses the y-axis. Well, look where it crosses the y-axis, right at a point 0, 0. Where does it cross the x-axis? Well, it doesn't technically cross. It just comes down and kisses at one spot. So it crosses it, it kisses at 0, 0. Notice it opens up. And notice that it has a minimum value of 0. All right. So there's some characteristics of that curve. It's got a vertex, so it changes direction at 0, 0. It's got a line of symmetry on the line x equals 0. It's got a domain all the way to the left and all the way to the right. It's got a range which is greater than or equal to 0. It's got a y-intercept of 0, 0, x-intercept of 0, 0. It opens up and it's got a minimum value of 0. The y's can come down as low as 0, which is pretty much what the range is telling you. All right. That's a pretty simple function. Right? Let's have a look at another one. So now leave your 1/2 x squared in the calculator, and now we're going to throw in the purple one there, y equals x squared itself. All right. So leave the other one in so you can compare it. Because you can actually graph like 10 things at once on that graphing calculator. It gets kind of busy. Right? So the green one was the 1/2 x squared. Now the purple one is the x squared. And notice it's the same shape, it's just stretched a little higher. So you're going to find out it's got the same vertex. It's got the same line of symmetry as the other one. Same line of symmetry, it's got the same domain. The thing does go forever to the right. It just takes forever. It just takes a little longer to get there. And it does go forever to the left. The function goes all the way up to, well, it goes all the way up to positive infinity on the y. It's got a y-intercept, the same as the previous one. It's got an x-intercept at 0, 0. It opens up. The only thing that really changed was by changing from a 1 half to a 1 in front of the x squared, it just stretched it up a bit. All right, next slide. Then we did y equals 2x squared. So we're looking at the red one now. So leave the other two in there. So we'll put this in equation number 3. So here's what y equals 2x squared looks like. There's y equals x squared, and there's y equals 1 half x squared in green. And, of course, the vertex of the third function, it's still the same. It still bottoms out at the same place. It still has the same line of symmetry. It's still got the same domain. It goes forever to the right and forever to the left. It just takes a little longer to get there in terms of the y. The y goes all the way up any number greater than 0. So it goes from 0 to infinity. Let's see, the y-intercept is at 0, 0, the x, it's all the same. The only thing that changed was it stretched it a little higher. Next slide. All right, so there's what happens when you make those coefficients negatives. Well, you know that a half flattens it, and a 2 stretches it. Well, guess what? Making it negative flips it upside down. You'll be doing tons of this in grade 12, trust me. All right. So you're starting to get a sense that you'll be able to look at a formula and go zing, zing, there's what it looks like. All right. So there we go. So now we've looked at what happens when you stick a number in front of the x squared. Well, what happens if you... So we know what happens when we put a number on that for that a. So you'll always be given the a. There'll be some number there. Right, it might be a negative number, it might be a positive number, it might be a fraction, right? But you'll always have a number there. So we played with that, we know what that does. What happens if you fling a number on the end, a constant on the end? We'll call it k, all right? And you'll always be given that, of course, usually. So what happens when you do that? What does that do to the curve and the relationship between the numbers? What does it do? All right, well, let's have a look. Let's graph y equals x squared plus 2. And there, it's in your notes, of course, so we draw the pretty diagram. Look what it looks like. I just got you to do it on the plastic brain. Down at the bottom, I drew it. So it's really the parabola, and everything shifted up. The vertex now is at 0, 2, as you can see from the graphing calculator. The domain goes for all x's, all the every possible x, from infinity to negative infinity. The range is, oh, all the y's are more than 2. See, the y's never do get down to 0 on this one, because everything's been moved up 2. The line of symmetry is still the same, etc. All right, and you can tell the line of symmetry. It's pretty easy to find because it's exactly the same as the x of your vertex. Because doesn't the line of symmetry go through the vertex? And your y-intercepts, where does this thing cross the y-axis? In other words, if it's a moose, where does it cross through the crosshair on your rifle, the vertical crosshair? So it's 0, 2. And the x-intercepts are nil. Notice this thing does not cross the x-axis. All right, so we're looking at the pretty blue diagram at the bottom. So keep going here. And then we got tired of doing that crap, so we just put all 5 of them in the calculator at once. All right, so we did x squared plus 2, x squared plus 1, x squared minus 1, x squared minus 2, and bada bing, bada boom, they look like this. All right, so you notice by monkeying about with the number at the end of the quadratic expression that it just moves things up and down. So it just means your sister was born earlier than you or whatever. All right, or maybe. Well. Okay, so there's the pretty picture you get on your graphing tool, the graphing calculator. Let's do the same thing here. Now, what happens now instead of flinging an extra number on the end of the expression if we add it to the 2 before we square it? All right, so before we square the x, we add another number to it, then we square it. Anybody into electronics, they know what I'm talking about here. All right, so let's try this. So now we're going to take the x and we're going to add a number to it, and then after we add the number, we're going to square it. Well, it turns out what it does is it moves everything left and right. By adding 2, it actually moves things to the left. And I'll explain why it moves it to the left. It's counterintuitive. Most people said, well, it must move it to the right. But no, adding a 2 moves the curve to the left. So, of course, now your line of symmetry runs straight up and down through x equals negative 2. And you'll see that your vertex is obviously at, well, look at it. Looks like it's at negative 2 comma 0 on your x comma y. And it's got a y-intercept, of course. Now, why is your y-intercept? Well, your y-intercept is where your x is 0. If you're hunting for moose and you see that vertical axis there in the center, that's where your x is 0. So where is your x 0? It says your x is, when your x is 0, you're on the y-axis, the vertical grid line in the center. So knowing where something crosses there is important. Just plug in an x of 0. So what is 0 plus 2 all squared? 4. So when the x is 0, the y is 4. Next slide. Okay, and I want to get this under an hour, so I got to accelerate this. It's got an x-intercept. It just kisses, comes down like that. Next one. And we do the same thing here. We explored all of these. You can do this on a graphing tool at home or a graphing calculator if you got one, or just do it on a bit of paper, because I'll give you graph paper up the yin-yang if you want. There you go. Here's x plus 1 squared. It's going to shift it. The vertex is at, obviously, negative 1 comma 0, etc. So the symmetries at x equals negative 1, x plus x minus 2 all squared. Look at that. It looks like that. Okay, so we did all that noise. Notice how by adding a number inside the brackets with the x before you square it moves things left and right. And then finally we get to do all that noise. All right, so what happens when you... So now you know that you can write a a quadratic equation as a times something in x plus something in brackets all squared plus some number. So if I give you something like that, you can pretty much see what's happening there. Can you see that that is going to be a happy face, right? Positive 3. Can you see the vertex is at positive 1 comma positive 2, and the 3 stretches it up higher? So here, you'll be able to see what it looks like. How about this one? And this one, the third one, all right? So, okay, now. So, the first one we discussed, the second one, it's going to be shifted to the right by 1, and it's going to be dropped 2, and then it's going to be stretched high. And then the third one, it's going to be shifted to the left 1, and it's going to be dropped 2, and it's going to be flattened out. So, let's just see how I did there, all right? Pretty soon, you'll be able to see these in your head. All right, so here's the first one being graphed, boom. Here's the second one being graphed, boom. Here's the third one being graphed, boom. There you go. You'll be able to do those in your head on the back of a cigarette pack. And to conclude, let's just have a look at these, because I want to keep this under an hour. There's your plain Jane y equals x squared parent function. So I hope everybody understands that the red thing there is y equals x squared. All right, when you got a 0, 0 squared is, yeah, okay, we'll carry on here. All right, so everybody understands that that x squared is the plain Jane simple thing before you start monkeying around with it. When you get something like this purple one, y equals 2, x plus 3 all squared minus 5, it's going to shift it to the left, it's going to drop it, and it's going to stretch it out. So it's going to look like that. Okay, there you go. Briefing is complete. Thank you.